I met him 15 years ago. I was told there was nothing left. No reason, no conscience, no understanding, and even the most rudimentary sense of life or death, of good or evil, right or wrong. I met this 6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face and the blackest eyes, the devil's eyes.
I prayed that he would burn in hell, but in my heart, I knew that hell would not have him.
When there's no more room in hell, the dead will walk the earth.
Escape! I get up and I can't escape. Anytime I can, it's all escape. I'm crying in my beard. Come on, let's escape. Just get me out of here.
Welcome back, everybody, to Scott's Strange Story. This is our third podcast, and today I've got two guests with me. First is, well, actually, this is a reunion of the greatest team on the Married with Children podcast. Well, maybe not the greatest, but certainly the most color. With me is Tyler. Tyler, how you doing?
Hey there, guys. It's your old Married with Children host, Tyler.
Yeah, and I'm also here with Stefan. Say hi to everyone.
Hello. Hi, everyone. I'm so excited to be doing this.
Yes, it's going to be fun because we were off in the trio on the Married with Children podcast, seasons 8 through 11, and we sure had a good time. Of course, I think Stefan really came in season 9 or 10. I couldn't remember.
I think it was season 10.
Yeah. Season 10, but we still had a great time doing it. And today we are going to be looking at something that Stefan recommended, and I had seen it, and it's called Hell House, LLC.
Yep, the LLC, not just plain old Hell House. That's a documentary, totally different.
Still good, though. I like it.
In some ways, that documentary is scarier than this movie, just saying. Yeah.
There was also a Hell House TV movie based on the novel written by Richard Matheson.
Oh.
Just to let people know. And the movie wasn't that good. The book is so much better. Which reminds me, as part of Scott Strange Stories, I am an outlet for my writing. And remember, the Demon Inside Me is still on sale for $14.99 on Amazon.com.
It's so good.
I've had a whole bunch of sales recently. It's kind of picking up a little bit. I'm glad for that. Mm-hmm. I'm working on the follow-up, and probably more news on that on the next podcast or the one after that.
It's a good time, listeners. I've read it. It's good.
I made them read it. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
I made them read it.
Yeah, he messaged me 500 times a day. Did you read it yet? What page you want? Would you read it yet? Did you read it yet?
No, I use the demonic forces to make you read it.
Oh, yeah, hunched over the toilet, staring at those pages.
Yeah. But let's talk about Hell House LLC. And Stefan, when did you first come across it? You recommended this one, and I agreed, but how'd you come across it?
Yeah, so I first heard of it on an article on a bloodydisgusting.com, which that's, if you don't know, listeners, that's like the go-to for horror news. It has everything. The article was about kind of like obscure, underrated found footage movies. It was a found footage or like haunted house movie, one of the two. And I read, I'm like, this sounds really good. And I watched it immediately. It was free on, I think, Netflix at the time, and it's free on YouTube, to like all the free streaming services have it. It's easy to watch. Do yourself a favor and watch it if you have not. And it was and still is one of the only movies to scare this seasoned horror fan.
And Tyler, when did you first come across it?
Well, I actually came across it not too long ago. It was not last year, but the year before. I was visiting my dad and just chilling, had the whole week off, had nothing to do. And I was looking at what was coming out, and something had just dropped on streaming, Hell House, The Origins. Now, they should have put a big old 4 on that because it's the fourth movie of a franchise. I did not know, but I watched it and thought it was pretty good. But I was like, man, this is really esoteric. Why am I not getting a lot of this? So I found out it was the fourth one in a series. So I was like, well, I'm a completist and I like to watch things as they come out. So I went back and watched the first one. Loved it. Amazing. I echo everything you said about that, Stefan. And then the second one, still pretty good. And the third, like, honestly, I see them as chapters in a book. And then the fourth one is like an epitaph, like extra juicy thing. So like, yeah, fans of this franchise have a lot of good juicy material that mm-hmm. all pays off in a way if you give it a time.
Yeah, right. even the third is generally considered the weakest, but there's still a lot of good about that.
Yeah, I felt like it was the last 15 minutes of it fell apart. But I first came across the Hell House series 2 years ago. I was listening to Brian and Jamie Salmon's House of Horror podcast, which is really gone. Well, they decided to stop. They're not doing it. Hopefully they'll pick it up sometime in the future, but they were talking about it. And so I took it in, and the first one I thought, wow, this is pretty damn good. And especially since, frankly, I thought the found footage had really burned itself out on me. But I found this one pretty interesting and really easy to follow, and it was pretty scary.
Yeah. And I would like to quickly give a dedication. Actually, this movie is kind of how I really became a fan of podcasts in general. So these old friends of my sister and myself, like I knew them too. The Scary Sisters was they called themselves. It's a now a defunct podcast. It was made up of three sisters that my sister and I grew up with: Mallory, Allison, and Whitney. My sister was good friends with Mallory in junior high and high school. And I knew Whitney. We were like acquaintances. And I asked, have you done this movie yet? And then they're like, yeah, we have. And that was the first podcast I ever listened to. And here I am now. So this feels like a full circle moment. I might reference some things they say in their episode, which you can't get it anymore. And I wish I still... It's so good. Dedicated to three of you. Hope you're listening. And thank you.
By the way, listeners, spoiler alert ahead, because we are going to be talking about this movie over the next hour or so and giving us our thoughts. And then my next podcast will be with another indie horror author. So be ready for that one. I haven't put up my feelers out yet on the internet, but I need to. And then we'll figure it out from there. I was surprised this movie wasn't released until 2016. And I don't know how I missed it released or anything. I noticed it was filmed in Lahinton, Pennsylvania. And it was the production company was the Cognetti Films and the Marvelous Boys. Mm-hmm. And of course, it stars a whole bunch of people I never heard of. I guess they maybe a one-up thing.
One of the actors had a decent sized role in The Substance.
Oh, really?
Which we'll get to that.
Who was that though?
That was the actor that played Paul. He was the obnoxious neighbor.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
I did see that. Stefan saw it. We recommend it. I don't know if Tyler's seen it, but Stefan.
Tyler has not seen it. So please, let's make this a spoiler hell, spoil Hell House all you want. Please do not spoil Substance for at least 24 more hours.
It's wild. I want to hear your thoughts on the Substance.
Yeah. We'll want to talk about that another time, possibly.
Yes.
But anyway, I did not know that about. Yeah. Gore Abrams played Paul. Alice Bakke played Diane. She was the journalist. Danny Bellini played Alex. Theodore Belaukos played Robert Lyons. He was one of the commentators who would explain something on this mockumentary. And Jared Hacker was Tony Prescott. And I think, Sarah Harville was played by Ryan Jennifer Jones.
Overall, I think everyone was cast really well. And they all look like real people. Mm-hmm. They don't look like movie stars. It really adds to the authenticity of it all.
Well, I think that's typical with a lot of found footage, that they use a bunch of unknowns, average-looking real people.
Right.
Yeah, so I think that's one benefit that genre has always had over a slick production from Hollywood or even an independent filmmaker. And I thought it was interesting because it does this thing that seems to have become popular over the last 15 to 20 years where you start at the end or you start in the middle, because you begin with the terrible thing that supposedly happened in 2009 at a Halloween tour at the Abaddon Hotel. And it caused 15 deaths caused by a malfunction of some sort.
Yeah, I like that format too. Some people don't. I do.
Well, it's a clever twist on the interesting format, because we're not just seeing the ending. We are seeing the ending from a particular point of view that is not showing us everything. And it's not tricky camera. Oh, wow. They're just deliberately not showing us everything. No, we're not seeing stuff because not everybody saw everything, which leads to the whole idea of, well, what did you see? Are you sure you saw that? I'm telling you, I heard this happen. Well, I'm sure if you asked every single person who saw this movie for the first time, they probably would give you a different account of the intro just by memory.
Probably.
Yeah, it's definitely a movie to watch multiple times. You pick up on stuff that you don't see, like in the background.
And I like to call this type of a movie a mockumentary, because it looks like a documentary that's looking at a real thing, but it's not. Very much like the Blair Witch Project. It was amazing how many people thought Burkesville was there was a real Blair Witch there when Blair Witch came out. So it did that very well. And by the way, I know one of the actors, portrayers in the movie talked about this a little bit, but the word Abaddon is a Hebrew word in the Jewish Bible. And what he said was quite a little bit off, and it means the place of destruction or the place of the dead. And in the Old Testament, quite often you'll see a word Sheol, which is literally translated as place of the dead, and sometimes the pit.
Hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. I was wondering about the religious stuff that they threw out there, and I was like, I'm going to let Steven just answer that for me, because I'm sure he'll have an answer.
Yeah.
So we get the introductions of what happened, like there was something that went wrong. They show pictures of people coming up from there. And when people get out here, there are the fire trucks and the ambulance, because people had called 911. And we find out that there's a YouTube video that was uploaded, but quickly taken down, and that there are gag orders on a lot of this evidence that was suppressed or kept hidden. Sarah Hobble says that people knew it would be too hard for them to deal with. And I was wondering, I don't think that'd fly in reality.
Gag orders as in, yeah, I could see that, because 15 people are dead. And that was probably a very intense investigation. And gag ordering happens when you need to suppress information to control the course of an investigation. So, I mean, if literally that many people died, I could see that being a thing. Like, so, yeah, like it leads to the intensity of what happened. That, like, this isn't just we're not just dealing with the hotel from the 80s. or 70s. We're dealing with a very recent tragedy.
I love like the lore and backstory, which I guess kind of leads into more, but I love just the writers really did a good job at fleshing that out. I love stories that have like lore that like they don't tell you, you don't see everything, they tell you and then you kind of infer.
Yeah, that, I like that too. I did enjoy that part. You know, and it's, I will say, it's kind of difficult if you guys could assist me, because I find it hard to, I've never done a found footage film retrospect like this. And so if you guys have any ideas, you know, please jump in and let me know. But basic plot is, you got these guys that are all working together. Here are these people, and they want to do a haunted house tour. And they're looking for a place. And it's Paul and Alex and Tony. And they're all trying to put it together. And they're on a road trip, and they're talking about what they want to do with it. And they go through this town, and they see the Abaddon Hotel, which is boarded up, looks like it's closed, and they think they have the place where they want to put it.
The aesthetic of this place is amazing.
Yes. Makes me wonder, for found footage films, how they go out deciding on a set place to film that.
I think it's very similar to how they did it in the movie. Like, you find the cheapest place, or AKA, or also the place that is most agreeable to you having more creative control over what you do with the area. Yeah, we gotta move these walls and build this room, that kind of stuff.
According to the trivia on IMDb, this movie was initially going to be shot in an old abandoned house, but I guess they found this and it worked better.
Yeah, I think it would too, as opposed to a simple haunted house, because you got so many, you got all the levels and the kitchen and all the other little nooks and crannies of a motel out in, you know, Podunk, New York or wherever.
Podunk, yeah, it's like, they make it sound like it's, and the origins, if we ever cover that movie, they try to make it seem like you're in the middle. It's like Rockland County, New York, in the middle of nowhere. It's like you're 45 minutes from Manhattan. That's not the middle of nowhere.
Well, but also that actually works pretty well for the found footage, because with the exception of like Cannibal Holocaust, the found footage darling is the Blair Witch Project, which they were in the movie and in real life, what, like 25 minutes, 35 minutes away from civilization, but it is possible to get lost. So you don't need to be that secluded out where you could be pretty much trapped.
Yeah. I meant how they make fun of, like, they call like, oh, we're in Podunk, you know, wherever. It's like, no, you're not. Anyways.
No, that's okay. Now, we do find out one thing. You know, after this tragedy, there was one person named Joey who witnessed some things, and he refused to talk about what happened, and he ended up hanging himself. And then we find out the backstory of the motel, that there used to be some guests, and they would abruptly just disappear. And the owner of the Abaddon Hotel originally was a guy named Andrew Tully, who killed himself in the dining room of the motel by hanging himself.
That picture is chilling that they show.
Yeah. And after the disappearance of a woman and her 11-year-old daughter.
Now, so, do you think they really, I mean, he was cleared, but like, and they said that he had records of them checking out, but do you think they really did?
No.
I don't know. It's possible, but of course, we're talking about a movie. So it's really hard to tell if it was true or not.
I mean, you got to watch the other movies, Stefan.
Yeah, true. I mean,
everything in that little background there is fodder for the future films.
You know, and then there is this one scene that stuck out to me on the rewatch that I did just last night, actually. And it was Paul who does a lot of the videoing. And apparently there was someone sleepwalking in his room, but you never see who it is. And it made me wonder, is this what's triggering it, or what's starting the supernatural things to happen? Or
wasn't it Sarah that was sleepwalking?
Well, we don't
I don't
know.
Know, man. Sarah's weird as hell in this movie, and she does some stuff that like weirds me out, and I never like I'm kind of wondering if they're just like, all right, she's the one girl, so we're gonna make her do weird stuff, like stare at a grave plot for no reason at all, and then be talking backwards and stuff, and it makes you think. I'm sorry, Steven. I don't know if you this you can cut this part out. I don't know if you are trying to go linearly throughout the entire film, but in the at the end, like I was forgetting in my mind, I was like, Sarah's in on it. Like Sarah gets infected. And then I get proven right at the end when you find out that it was her ghost who was leading the director. But then you find out at the end that she actually was trying to get out and Paul killed her. Like, so they pulled the rug out from underneath me with Sarah like three times.
Well, the spirits like possessed her, kind of like, you know, I think it's equivalent to like Jack Torrance in The Shining.
He was just misunderstood. He was just trying to get writing done.
Oh, good point.
Yeah, I'm a writer. Yeah. I feel his pain.
One thing I love, so if we're like jumping around a bit, so when we first meet Sarah, so it's 5 years after the tragedy, so we're in 2014, and Diane Mitchell, and then a third, whoever's recording, I don't remember his name, they've been contacted by Sarah, who said she wants to be interviewed and that she has footage of their stay at the hotel when they were setting up for the attraction, what happened on opening night. And I love when she first is being interviewed, how she says, "I'm in a better place." That's foreshadowing.
Yeah. Never thought about that.
My last note for that last scene was the trap, Sarah's trap worked at the end. And this goes to show you never trust a true crime honeypot.
You know, and then there was the other thing. They did show the YouTube video that was, uploaded that the police, I guess, took down. I don't know how they were able to do that. But, you had that to kind of whet our appetites. And it does make you wonder what happened down there. We don't know. And you don't hear from about the testimony that people made to the police or in court. And then we just start this tale about, or the story about the kid, these guys making a haunted house for Halloween. And I got to say, some of those props that they had were just amazing.
Yes.
Oh yeah. This haunted house looks awesome.
For sure. And I feel like, if you've ever done a haunted house, they deliberately they do a musky odor kind of to add to it. Mm-hmm. I feel like I could smell this place through the screen.
Yeah. In Michigan, we have a thing called Erebus. They have it started off as just like one floor of this warehouse in Detroit. And now they own the entire warehouse. So it's like five levels. It's built like a parking garage where you just go through these different rooms. Sometimes the floor drops like a half a foot with you on it and stuff. Jesus. Like that, it shakes, like some of them are on platforms that shake and everything, and the walls slide around. It's similar to this but on a grander scale. It looks like something that Alex would be trying to build towards.
Is it one of those where you have to sign a waiver?
Oh, I mean, you have to sign a waiver at all of them. I'm sure they signed one at Hell House. You don't want someone having a heart attack or something like that, or having an asthma attack or a panic attack, kids slipping and falling.
You the one in Duluth, we had there's the haunted ship. There's a docked boat, the William A. Irving, that they turn into a haunted ship every Halloween. And for that, you don't need a waiver.
Yeah, they're asking for a lawsuit.
I mean, there must be something like a disclaimer. But usually the waiver, the ones you have to sign, you have to be 18, and it usually says like they can touch you.
Those super interactive ones. Yeah, I ain't doing those. I don't want them touching me.
I did one of those, like, I think years ago, probably like 2015, when I first moved to the Twin Cities. And I'll send you a picture of the aftermath of me. It was wild.
Anyhow, you know, one of the first things that stood out to me was the Hector doll or the mannequin.
What?
Or the Hector who was sitting on the piano. And I forget who was playing that ominous music. And what I'm trying to say about Hector is he is just so creepy from the get-go. It's kind of like, you know, he's going to do something later. Kind of like in, I don't know how you honestly felt about it, but that Oddity movie that I really liked, Stefan, you said, I couldn't tell if you liked it or not, but you just know that thing is alive. You just can't tell. And anyway, Hector creeped me out. And then they got those dummy clowns that they're working on.
Oh,
so smart to never see. We never see any movement of the dummies, correct?
No.
Mm-mm. No. Never. Until the second movie you do.
Yeah, that's why I didn't like. I didn't like that in the second movie. But no, that was such a smart choice to just have them in different positions.
When the camera moves away and then it moves and the heads have moved, that, yes.
That, you know, that was the first really big scare for me in this one. You know, you turn, he's looking one way, then the camera comes back and he's looking the other way. Jeez, that just scared the hell out of me.
When Tony, this is after Paul has his little freak out and comes back all quiet and everything, and they have the Tony, one of the other guys is now doing the filming, and they see the clown move and he's like, I want to quit, like F this, blah 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 blah, which I'm totally on his side. Later, the next scene, McNamara, the tall guy, comes up and he's like, hey, look, you can't quit, because, and it cuts to him just sitting in a field saying, you're right, I can't quit. Do they ever give a reason for why he shouldn't quit?
Sort of. There is in 2 and 3, there's like you see a conversation that Alex has with some, I'm not going to spoil who, but yeah, they kind of, yeah.
Because it looked like, I don't know if they were just doing that because they trust the audience to pick up on the chemistry between the guys that we would believe that McNamara would be able to talk Tony down. Or is there something that like makes Tony feel either obligated or now he's roped in?
Somewhere? I mean, they established that this group, they've worked together for years and been friends even longer. Yeah. And can I just say, I don't care how much money I would lose. I would long have been gone for sure. For sure. The night when like the candles appear lit.
I would have been gone earlier.
Steven, when was your I'd be out?
Okay. Point? When those clowns are moving around, you know, that one clown, you know, staring at you, and then, you know, that just would. I'm sorry, I got a low threshold of dealing with the evil, okay?
I mean, I would have been gone probably at that point too, but at the very latest, I would have been gone when like it, the clown moved that quickly that night, and then the clock went off and the candles were lit. Like at that point, it's like I would immediately pack up and leave in the middle of the night. I wouldn't care. I'll sleep in that car.
I would have been gone, to be completely honest, I would have been gone the second you guys told me I have to sleep in that hell house.
Right.
Absolutely not. I'll work on it all day and night, and I'll work on it all night alone, but I'm not sleeping in there. No. Get me a Motel 6.
I agree. I'd sleep in the van or the car.
Well, I'd sleep in a ditch.
But if you were able to talk me into actually sleeping there for haunting purposes, quite honestly, the second that sleepwalker came in, and because I emoted myself to Paul, because when I sometimes do video, you know, journaling, how he does it on his bed is kind of how I do it. And when he's just like, oh, is that Sarah? Is that House? Hey, dude, what's up? And it just vaults away. No, I would have been vaulted off the bed, and I'd been like, hey, yo, what's going on? Why are you staring at me? What's going on up here? Yeah. And then if there was nobody there, I would I'd be gone the next morning being like, hey, you can find me down the road at the nearest hotel.
I always love, it's such a creepy touch how Paul would sign off. He'd be like, sleep sweet. Something about that just creeps me out.
You know, he's a
creepy guy.
Yeah. I will say he was definitely cracking up. I mean, he refers to a small child. You know, that sleepwalker comes in and it's not Sarah. And he puts the covers over his head like a little kid. He's hiding under that cover. And he's trying to work up some nerve to pull the cover down and take a look. Then it goes back up. And then it stays up for the longest time before it comes back down again. And then, woof, he's like disappeared the next day.
This, the first time I saw this, this made my heart race. Like this, one of the, like this scene is a masterclass in horror and tension. It's like, it elevates this movie. It's perfection as far as I'm concerned.
And then when they find Paul, I think 24 hours or 48 hours later, I can't remember.
It was less than 24. It was like the next day, less than 24 hours.
I had no memory of him being found again. I thought he was gone for good from my first time watching. I had totally forgotten they found him again.
Yeah, but he was in a catatonic state. You know, he couldn't answer him. He couldn't talk to him. And that makes
sure I would be like, we need to get him to a doctor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I like this. This is not normal. He is not just like I know he had a reputation as being a jokester. They kind of established that. But I'd be like, with all the weird shit going on, I'd be like, no, let's, like, we need to get him to a doctor or the hospital or urgent care or something.
Yeah. And you might remember when they did find him, they were looking around with those clown dummies or whatever. And all three of them had turned to look at, I forget who it was who was doing the footage after that, Tony, I think. And they said, oh, my God, all three of them are looking at us now. I mean, that was really good.
Oh, I was just saying, like, leave.
Yeah.
Get the fuck out of there.
It's like the old Eddie Murphy joke. Why are white people so dumb they stay in a haunted house?
But because they're trying to build a haunted house, that's one of the reasons why this one works, is they actually have a reason. And the person finding it is, boy, they just give a really good idea of, like, what a practical joker Paul must be. Because, man, they are not willing to believe him for a long time. It's unlike other found footage where you're right, like, get the heck out of here. This one actually has a real reason. This is their job. Like, they got stuff to do, and I'm sure they've encountered quote unquote real horror stuff before, because that just shows you the type of people they are.
I mean, I don't think anything like this. I hope not.
And I will say, you know, I would have my breaking point of leaving, like you said, Stefan. I don't care how much money I lose, but at the same time, when you're invested into it highly, it's like difficult to, I imagine it would be difficult for a lot of people just to walk away after investing probably thousands of dollars into doing that.
But not just the money. Years of your life. I can just quit my job and get another one. If I started a business with somebody and everything, like, you can't just like hop onto the unemployment line and like find another job really quickly. That's a whole lifestyle.
In that case, I mean, that's fair, but still, I would not be staying the night there anymore. I would go during the day, work on it, and when the sun goes down, I'm out.
I'm out too. I'm not advocating of why you and me should stay there. I'm saying that the reasons why this works so well as found footage is that we have a in-world reason rationally why they would. And they keep saying, like, 3 days till opening night. We all have to do is keep this thing open for a few days, and it pays for our entire year.
That would be really attractive. And so that's the temptation. Do you go through with it, or do you risk your sanity? And there are people, I mean, I don't know how far I'd go. Guys, to give you an idea, you know, I still haven't broke even on the book yet. I still haven't. If you look at what I spent on the cover, advertising, some things I needed, tables, I'm probably not going to break even for another year or so from now, if I'm lucky. But I'm putting a lot into this. And so if this is what you really want to do with your life, you know, yeah, it's going to be a lot more of a temptation than just a simple job of some sort. Real quick, I was just thinking, now it's a few days later for opening night, and they can't get Paul to wake up. That's a big red flag for me. I mean,
again, like he needs medical intervention at this point.
Yeah. And just to think that he's still sleeping through all this for the most part, you know, it's just beyond, you know, thinking. I mean, how can you sleep through all this? I mean, unless you are just really sick of some, really sick of something, you know, actually a virus of some sort that's just, you know, knocked you on your ass.
Yep. Or is it just Paul being really committed to his long-term joke? Maybe this is how Paul gets when he's like depressed and stuff like that.
I'd be more inclined to believe the depression as opposed to sticking to a joke.
True. I'm just saying, like, I can at the end of the day, you're just like, oh, it's opening night. You can get through this, and then we'll get Paul all the help he needs.
Yeah.
Like, I'm on their side mentally. Like, even though I know what's going to happen, I'm like, right. I want them to do it. And that's a testament to this group's chemistry and the journey I've been on with them so far.
And then the night before, that's when the music was playing, and they went down and they saw that dummy Hector. And you're thinking to yourself, oh, shit, Hector is alive. He's playing the damn piano. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, all the stuff that's going on in here is just so overwhelming and so unbelievable. It's just amazing how they built on this tension and kept building it up and building it up and maintaining that level without giving a full release. Because you don't get a full release until after the credits are rolling. Frankly,
the tension build, the slow tension build day to day reminds me of a lot of the Paranormal Activity movies, where it's like it's each night things just get worse and worse and worse, and you're dreading it more and more and more.
Yeah, I can see that.
I know those movies kind of are mixed in the horror movie. The first three scare the bejesus out of me.
I don't remember much about the third one. I remember the first two, and I like them.
Third is worth it, if nothing else, for the final, like, 10 minutes.
So they have their opening night, and you can see all these people coming in. I mean, they're lined up, and, you know, Tony and Alex and all them, they are just thrilled to see all these people. And I want to go back to the beginning when they were in the car. I can't remember if it was in the car or if they were in the motel talking about plans for it, but they talked about having one of the clowns being a real burly guy, you know, with lots of muscle to help to protect the other girl that was going to be chained up there, and he had her keys and everything to let her loose if something happened. You know what I'm talking about?
Why would you not do quick release handcuffs?
That probably would have been smarter.
No, and I was scared for Melissa, right? That Melissa was the one chained up, like right from the, where they're like we're at the interview where they're like, they joke, like, take your top off. I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I felt uneasy for Sarah even a little bit too. I'm not saying these were bad guys, but just Sarah being the only women in a group of like four other guys. I mean, yeah, you know, the founder of the business was your longtime boyfriend, but still, when the guy, like when Tony or Paul, when Paul walks in with the camera, when they're in bed in their underwear, I'm just like, oh, okay.
Yeah. That was,
I've been on long work trips before, Stefan. Things can get weird. When you sleep in the same rooms and you share the same stuff, you start getting like boundaries start getting a little bit like that to me was fun goofing around kind of stuff.
I mean, I know, and obviously they've worked together for years. I mean, I don't know, but that's why I insist on separate rooms. On vacation, I'm going to Memphis in a couple weeks with one of my best friends, and she's like, we can share a hotel. I'm like, no, let's get an Airbnb with two bedrooms, plus it's cheaper. So I digress.
Yeah, I do like one of a joke that made me laugh that wasn't really a joke was when it's when Paul has his first run in with the clown and he cuts to them looking at his footage, and it's just Alice is like, Jesus Christ, Paul, how much did you shoot today? He's like, it's coming. Just keep going.
Yeah.
I film everything because we're in a found footage movie. I film everything.
Exactly. Like, what do you want? This is what we do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you couldn't have a found footage film unless you have that one guy who's videoing everything, be it on his iPhone or whatever.
And I've never met anyone like that in real life that, I mean, would do to that extent. I mean.
Oh, I have. I've been on projects. You definitely need people like that. I see them at projects and at festivals all the time. They're there to document everything and have video of everything from all different angles. Fans pay extra to have access to that kind of stuff. It's real. So,
I mean, yeah, in an event like that, annoying. Sure.
And I guess I could see it because it's something they want to archive and keep as a memory, and probably also for business records. Who knows? Because they are operating a business for the most part.
Can we talk about the strobe light scene? Yeah, this is another really scary scene. And I love how Tony, Tony or whoever was like, he's like, how many freaks are there? Three freaks. Just how he says that. It's like chilling. My first experience of a haunted attraction ever in Anoka County, just north of the Twin Cities, like a northern suburban area, is known as the Halloween capital of the world. They do a big parade, they decorate the town, and they had this really freaky haunted attraction at this barn, abandoned barn, and they don't have it anymore. It was scary. I went in as like probably I was like seven probably, and they do like the tricks with the strobe lights. A light will come on and someone in like with a chainsaw and a hockey mask will run out at you. The light will go off, they'll turn on, be a different place. And like my mom, we were walking through, she trips over something, a light comes on, she's sitting in the lap of this guy in an electric chair. It was so scary. And that I think was because I was like into it and not crying. And I was like almost leading the group. And that probably was my horror awakening where I realized like, I like this. I like being scared. Sorry to digress.
I mean, I'm writing horror now. Who knows what's going to happen in the future, but you know, as human beings, we don't know what it's like to be truly scared because, you know, for thousands of years, you know, we had these hunting gathering societies. You had to go out and hunt your food. And sometimes, a lot of times that food could hunt you back, you know, facing a mountain lion or a grizzly bear or something like that. You know, we don't know what that's like. We really insulate ourselves from horror. And I think that's why it appeals to us so much because, you know, it does give you a general rush, doesn't it, of adrenaline and your blood pumping really fast. And I think that's why horror movies are very popular.
Mm-hmm. Especially
as someone with mental health issues, studies have shown that it can provide a release.
Mm-hmm.
I feel it.
It also helps people connect with things that they haven't connected with. Cause everyone knows like watching abuse from a parent in a horror movie is cathartic for people who went through that abuse. It's also cathartic for me to see that type of abuse could happen because I have no past abuse that I know of. And it's helpful for me to like, I don't know, just experience or sideline these worlds and helps me better understand my friends and people in the world who have had that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I think that's a good insight.
Yeah. You know,
it's
one of the best quotes I ever heard, again, on Bloody Disgusting, was on some article. I think about, it was analyzing like some, like it might've been Candyman or a Jordan Peele movie. And the final line, it's not gore, violence, or menacing that is truly that is the most frightening thing, but the uncomfortable truths that horror conveys about the world.
Sounds like Alex Navarro.
Yeah. You mean Megan Navarro?
I'm sorry, Megan Navarro, not Alex. Sorry, Megan Navarro.
Yeah. Megan's great. Love her work.
Alex's new podcast called The Dead Man's Party. They were reviewing movies from the 80s and 90s. And they did review Halloween 2 to do or they just got through doing the Halloween 2. And they broke it into two episodes. And they come to the scene in Halloween 2 after Michael breaks into the schoolhouse and leaves the word Samhain in there, which is really pronounced Salem. And Dr. Loomis explains what it means. And he talked about the fire rituals Druids had of burning people alive. And they would watch them to see if they can gain insights to the future. And then he says, Halloween isn't ghosts and hobgoblins. It's the unconscious mind. We're all afraid of the dark inside of ourselves. Now, as corny as that can be, he pulls it off. But there is a lot of truth to that. We don't want to look at the dark inside of ourselves. And I think I made this a comment on my author Facebook page that I think people who are into horror are capable of looking at themselves a lot better than people who don't like horror.
Oh, yeah. I don't have any fancy quotes, but I do have a question that we could all answer, and I think our audience might be interested in it as well. Paranormal Activity movies like these ones, dealing with the supernatural and stuff, can affect you based on your personal experiences and beliefs. Now, do any of us believe in the ghosts and the paranormal? And I mean that as in like ghosts, spirits. Steven, I want to move away from the idea of religious demonic possession, and I mean people casting spells on other people, like doing rituals and stuff like that, demonic stuff, rather than the existence of the evil and demonic, because I think we can all agree there is probably something.
Oh, okay. Yes, I have had a couple of experiences of supernatural entities. I can explain them. They weren't, you know, long and drawn out like a big haunted house movie. And it's really hard to describe them. And I kept looking for a logical reason. I kept looking for one. And I just could not find it in my heart or in my mind. How do I reconcile this? So, yes, I do believe from two experiences that I've had.
Okay. Stefan?
I have not, and I kind of want to have an experience, honestly. Ryan and I were just at a historic downtown hotel south of the Twin Cities this past weekend, and it's rumored to be haunted. You know, like every historic downtown hotel is haunted. Let's just be honest. It comes with a
something's term. Happened there.
Exactly. And not just like the Cecil, which that I'm sorry, that place wasn't haunted. It was just a shithole. yeah, Elisa Lam was not possessed, but that's another conversation. So we're sleeping in the middle of the night, and Ryan like starts screaming. Like he's still half, he's screaming. I wake up like, what? He's like, I thought I saw something was crawling in our window. And, you know, I was there. I didn't see anything. I mean, it was probably just a, you know, bad dream. I've been in places where a friend of mine has, like, my longtime best friend, Kyle, was really religious when we were younger. And we were, like, looking in the window of, like, a church by my house at middle of the night. And he's like, did you see that? I'm like, no. He's like, don't you see that? And it points. I'm like, I don't see anything. So take that as you will.
Well, Tyler, you answered the question. What about you?
Yes, well, I am a walking agnostic, and yeah, just like pure agnosticism. I don't know, but I'm willing to accept evidence as it's shown to me. That being said, I have never had a single shred of paranormal activity in my life. Not even one where I could like, what was that? Or even question at it. And I'm kind of on Stefan's side. It kind of bums me out. Like, part of me does want to experience it, but also I also avoid it. Like, I was never one to, I had some friends back when I was like 10 or so, and they wanted to play this game called hide and seek, where you go inside, all three of you go into like a completely dark room, you light a candle, you say these phrases over and over, and it's supposed to summon a demon to do your will or your wishes and stuff. And I'm like, nope. They're like, hey, you want to play with this Ouija board? Nope. Oh, come on, Tyler. It's not like you believe this stuff. Don't care. Playing it safe. I'm not doing any sacrilegious stuff in churches. I'm not burning. No, I'm not making fun of no synagogues or any type of like witchcraft thing. I mean, hey, if it like, and here's why. Imagine if you're a ghost, okay? Like really just a spirit chilling, you're floating around, and you see a bunch of teenagers, both of you guys, and you see a bunch of teenagers trying to do a Ouija board or like summon the spirits. Are you not going to want to F with them? Of course you are. And you're nice spirits. Imagine what the nasty ones are going to do. So you're just asking for trouble. So that's how I would approach this kind of stuff. So the closest I'm going to get is watching paranormal movies.
What about going to like a haunted locale or something?
Depends. If it's I'm a corporate guy. So like if it's a business and I have like waivers and legal stuff that I can read to make sure we're protected and everything's on the up and up. Mm. Totally. If you are like, hey, Tyler, we're visiting, let's go down to this abandoned church that caught on fire in 1890. Let's explore it. I'm like, you have fun. I'm staying here and getting high.
Like,
no
I mean,
way,
I wouldn't.
Sir.
I wouldn't go in the middle of the night like a ghost tour. I mean, I'm not. If I do a Ouija board, it's going to be one that has the Parker Brothers seal on the box. I'm not doing one that's like possessed by a demon or whatever, you know, not like one of those. But yeah, I think a lot of it is people see what they believe. I always ask, and there have been a couple pictures, but not many, you know, certain places they say have an energy or they're haunted. A lot of times where people have died, why do we never hear about any hauntings at like Auschwitz or Dachau, where millions of people met their deaths? And I mean, I've seen a couple pictures of supposed ghosts there, but there's really nothing. I mean, maybe, and you'd think there would be tons of that there, but, or maybe
Stefan,
people just
why
don't...
would you want to hang around Auschwitz? That's depressing, even if you died there.
Well, or maybe people don't want to look out of respect.
That too. Yeah,
I mean, I'm just putting that out there. That's
I am
all
surprised
saying.
We're not seeing like Auschwitz YouTube jumpers hopping through places and stuff like the streamers did for the suicide forest in Japan.
I mean, I don't. Yeah, I'm sure some people have tried, but you know, I don't know.
Yeah,
well,
it's interesting.
I found out just a quick search. Yeah, there are some reports of hauntings in Auschwitz and Dachau. So
you don't say.
Yeah, but we need to move on here.
Yes.
Sorry.
Go back to the movie, but it was a great discussion. I really like this stuff. And by the way, Tyler, I tried to be an agnostic, but I had doubts about my doubts. So I had to.
Oh, it's not for the faint of heart. It's not a warm, loving thing. And it's not something you could just go, well, I don't know. A lot of people think agnosticism means I don't know and I don't care. No, I don't know, and I will constantly always search.
Yes, that's the best way to describe an agnostic. I heard someone once say agnostics are atheists without balls.
They're
no, I'm just kidding.
They're atheists with manners.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
Well, if you're Stephen Hitchens or Christopher Dawkins, the renowned atheist, he says like agnostics need to get off the fence or whatever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think everyone is a little bit agnostic, whether or not they admit it or not. I think I always ask even people that are like, you know, like fervent believers, like, you know, to the point where they want to, like, you know, enact policy based on their religion. I'm like, you know, have you ever wondered that you might be wrong about it, about Hail what payment. You believe to be true? And this one guy, not one of those kind of people, because if you say no, you're lying to yourself. This one pastor was like, well, of course, because to have faith, you have to have a level of doubt at times. Faith is challenged every day.
Yeah, you're right.
That's the correct answer. But anyways, Paul, the actor who played Paul after the strobe light scene, when he pukes, he's really puking.
I believe it. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, that flashing light alone would be enough to make me want to puke. That would drive me batty. But yeah, that strobe light scene was fantastic.
Yes.
Because you could see there was more than three in there at a few times.
And they were moving like, slowly. Or it looks like everything's moving slower with strobe lights, but they're not.
You know, the only time I really don't like the found footage, and we have this maybe two, maybe three times in this movie, where they're running around with the camera. And, you know, it just gives me a sense of, I don't know how you describe it, you know, a sense of nausea.
Motion sickness.
Yes. And that's my biggest pet peeve with found footage films, when they run around.
A lot of people say that. I've never felt it, but I've been on roller coasters for years, but I get that.
It is 100% a personal aesthetic. And when people say that that's the reason why they're not into found footage, I stop even trying to, like, get them into it, because I'm like, yeah, that's just, it's kind of part of the run.
Okay. But anyway, it's the opening night, and after about, you know, not very many showings, you know, they let in so many at a time, which is typical of those types of attractions.
It's packed on the inside. It's like dense.
And
people coming through.
Yeah. And when everything, you know, falls to shit, I guess you can say, and everyone's running out, you know, you're half beginning a mix of people with their smartphones taking YouTube videos or just taking videos. So it's to be spliced in there. And this is also when Joey runs out of the basement. You know, he had the keys to let that girl out, and she's yelling at him, please let me out. And he just bails out and takes off on her.
And anyway, you wonder, you think that's why he hung himself, out of guilt?
Maybe.
Because he wasn't really there for like the super scary stuff that really happened.
They got her first because she was chained. They'll get all the rest eventually.
What? Sorry.
Sorry. That's just how I'm not using the sequels. This is just my interpretation of what's going on with these things, because like they never really tell you. You had to kind of just figure it out for yourself. Mm-hmm. That there, this home, this area is linked and held by some form of presence. And whenever you get into it, it can find a way to infect you, and it wants to eat. And, well, it tasted you, and now it's time to eat, and it'll move, and then eventually it'll lure you back, and eventually it'll get you. So
I like that.
Yeah.
And it had a taste, certainly had a taste of Sarah and wanted all of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
You see, and that was the thing that towards the end, it wasn't the complete end, but you go back to Sarah talking to, I think her name was Diane, and her photographer, and she wants to take a break, and she's staying in, 2C. In 2C.
2C.
And then, I mean, and then they ask, where's this girl staying at? And she says she was staying in 2C. Well, we don't have a 2C. We don't do our numbers like that. And then And I remember I was watching this just last night. Like I said, again, I didn't remember this from the first showing, from the first time I watched it. But when they go into the Abaddon, you know, Diane and her photographer, and they see that 2C, there's like a little light on it, like a sun is shining through a little crack or something. And that part there, I was thinking, holy crap, she's staying in there? And yeah, that's where she is.
Yep. Her better place.
Yeah, that just, and that just kind of shows that this thing has taken over her.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the idea that she technically, I'm sorry to interrupt, when she said I'm staying in 2C, I want to believe that she never left. And that when she said that in the meeting room, she meant that as not past, present, but present tense. I'm there right now. You can find me there. Yeah.
Yep. So I love the execution of this where it's like Mitchell Kavanaugh stayed behind to look at the footage. What we're about to see can't be explained. And in the footage we previously saw, we saw the chaos on opening night. Sarah's nowhere to be seen. Where's Sarah? And, you know, she, we see many of them die. We see like Tony getting hung and like McNamara is like set upon by the robed demons, whatever they are. Maybe it was reverse. Maybe McNamara.
No, you're right.
Yeah. And so Sarah and Paul is now up and up. He's awake. And Sarah is like, we got to get it, you know, and then Paul beats her to death with the camera and very brutally, and then slits his throat with a piece of glass. And this was going back where there was the photographer who broke into the hotel to get pictures. And this part is creepy to me. I forgot to touch on it, where he's like, you know, I've traveled the world. I've seen some pretty disturbing things. There was no way I was going down those steps to the basement.
Yep.
And the picture with like the handprint. Oh, and he mentions how the report showed someone had their throat slit and it was self-inflicted. So that was Paul.
Oh.
Yeah.
And then, so we cut back to Diane and the cameraman. Mitchell, poor Mitchell. He tries and he calls her. And it's like, she's like, oh, it's Mitchell. I'll call him back. I'm just like, goodbye. Goodbye, Diane. You're toast. And I don't know if she turned the ringer off, but if that was me, I would be like fucking blowing up your phone. I would have been like, get the hell out of here. Get back here and see this, what I found. I mean, she probably turned the ringer off, but still. And Diane in this scene gives me major Gale Weathers vibes, and I kind of love it.
Yeah, good point.
Yeah, she's like, you know, wants the story, you know, you got to get the scoop. Like, we're here. Mm-hmm. It's what we're here for. We want, you know, enter 2C. Come on. Yeah. Come on.
We pretty much are. I just wanted to add on the ending right there, and that I like that vagueness that, you know, it was chilling to watch, you know, what Mitchell saw at the very end of the footage after, pardon me, that was before, but lost my train of thought here. But, you know, they go into the motel and they see the 2C and they go in, they see Sarah, and then you find out what the other guy found on the end of the footage right there. And I thought it was a really well thought out how they were going to end it and keep throwing twists. Like you said, Tyler, before we really got started today, they kept pulling out the rug from underneath you. And yeah. I felt the same way. That's where I find this incredibly satisfying.
Yes. Did you notice too, when Diane and the cameraman were going through, when they were in the kitchen, you could see Andrew's ghost in the background?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Thank you, Stefan. My last note for the ending, I love how when they are filming the individual where Diane and her cameraman are filming different parts, and then they'll just silently cut to like 2 seconds of the crew doing their thing in the past.
Uh-huh.
But there's no speech. There's just like silence around it. And it just, it feels like the walls are enclosing around me while I was watching it last night. And I'm just like, something bad is about to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Like, ugh.
So
it was good.
Just to wrap this up, Tyler, how many, let's see here. How many times are you going to go through the Abaddon Hotel out of 5?
Sir, I am going through the Abaddon Hotel 5.5 times. That last time is a little difficult. And I just can't really I just need to tap out on that like fifth run through. Mostly it'll be easier for me to say what didn't work for me. The only thing that didn't work for me was the, and I could probably do it better now, was the sound, like the digital fuzzing out.
Uh-huh.
It was a little too much. It starts to grate on you. Like, you get it. Be more attentive to the camera. Don't try to be so realistic. You have my attention, especially doing that stuff like in the last 25 minutes. You already have my attention. I've been here this long. I'm not going to ask questions. Be more creative with the visuals. Don't just keep cutting away and making me guess. Besides that, everything, the chemistry between the crew, the use of set, the idea that this is a horror film, this is a haunted house being built in a haunted house, and just the execution. I cared about these guys. I wanted them to succeed. And it's just a great found footage film to show people what is good about found footage.
Stefan, how many times are you going to go through the Abaddon Hotel?
Out of how many are we 5? Doing? You did 5.5.
Yeah, Tyler did 5.5, but I said how many out of 5?
I
did.
I meant, I am so sorry, Stephen. I meant 4.5, but you know what?
Okay. Oh, okay.
I meant 4.5.
Okay.
Yes, 4.5.
That's fine.
I struggle with that fifth go around. That's what I meant.
Okay.
For me, 5.5. If I could do more, I would. Takes a lot to really freak out this seasoned horror fan, and this movie did it. I think it is a masterclass of found footage, horror, tension. It's perfectly cast, directed, edited. I echo everything you said, Tyler, and I love it. Just chef's kiss. I'm so glad I discovered this movie. Thank you, Bloody Disgusting, and thank you, Scary Sisters, once again, for kind of amplifying my interest in it. God, I can't believe it was, I want to say 2018. I think 2018 was when I first saw this movie, 2017 or 2018, and I've loved it ever since.
Okay. I, too, I'm going to give it 4 out of 5. Reiterating what Tyler said about the graphic things going out. And again, if you're making found footage, don't be running with the camera. Please don't do that. You can't even tell what's going on. It's just that you're running. But I thought the characters were good. The situation was good. And the execution was done very well. Again, those dummies, you never see them moving, but they are. And to me, it's what you don't see that scares you, in my opinion.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Yeah. Well, that's about all the time we have for this Scott's Strange Stories. Hopefully in a couple weeks, we'll have a new one out. And until then, remember to read, 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 and write, write, write. Scott's Scary Stories Podcast would like to remind you to look at the latest book by Stephen W. Scott, The Demon Inside Me, a first-person account of demonic possession. What's going on in the mind of the person possessed? How does he perceive his mother and sister and the priest trying to help him? Available on Amazon and for order in most bookstores. Right now it's on sale for $12.99 on Amazon until November 1st. Never sleep. again.
Ha 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 ha